My name is Aitor Arcoreca. I am associate professor in the University of the Basque Country, and I will be one of the presenters of the third webinar of the dynamic calculation method for building energy performance assessment webinars. The other presenter will be Maria Jose Jimenez from the CIEMAT, and she will be making her presentations from 11 to 11:50 in my local time, and I will make the presentation now from 10 to 10:50. Between 10:50 and 11, you will have 10 minutes for questions. You can make the questions during the presentation in the QAM box, and Maria Jose will answer her questions from 11:50 to 12. So, if you have any problem with your sound, yeah, you can read whatever is here, and you can check in the audio and video browser the speaker and microphone settings, so you can arrange it to correctly follow this webinar. And the questions, you will see in your screen this box, Q&A box. So please, if you have any questions, you can write them there. And yes, please do not use the chat box to ask the questions. And some notes. Yeah, you know this webinar is organized by Dynasty and facilitated by INIVE, and the webinar will be recorded and published in the Dynasty webpage here within a couple of weeks, along with the presentation slides. In case your question have not been answered, please send them to Maria Jose or directly to me, to Aitor Arcoreca, to our emails. And the remaining questions will be answered during the last webinar of the 3rd of September. Yeah, the ones that cannot be answered in the 10-minute question place will be answered the 30th of September. So now we will start with the first presentation of this third webinar. It's titled Introduction to Measured Data, Instrumentation and Sensors in Relation to Building Physics and Energy Performance. What is important to know? So basically the presentation has two main parts. This first part is more related to understand the physics behind the energy performance of buildings, mainly related to the building envelope performance. And then you have a second part where I will be talking to you about measurements. Yeah. What can you measure in the buildings? And why do you measure these things in the buildings? So this webinar, five webinars you are following, they are related on understanding the building energy behavior. And one of the main issues to characterize the building is the building envelope. Yeah. Through the building envelope, we have many things occurring. We can have solar gains, we can have losses due to ventilation or infiltration, we can have losses due to transmission losses, we can have heating inputs, or we can have, in case of the building has occupants, we can have metabolic heat gains, and electricity consumptions within the building that are also heat gains. So the thing is that if we want to characterize this building envelope once the building is constructed, yeah, here you have this small box that you will be analyzing with the mathematical techniques that are presented in this set of webinars. You have to measure the things that can be measured. Yeah, and then those measurements will be related through some models, and you will estimate some parameters regarding this building envelope. Yeah, here you have a window, and this box has some walls with some thermal characteristics. So the first part of this presentation is just to let you know that there are some physical phenomena occurring in the envelope of these buildings. Yeah, I will present you what is the physical meaning of what's going on in these transmission losses and the physical part of what's going on in the ventilation and infiltration. And then we will go to the monitoring part. We will go to see what can we measure to make, to fit those models you are learning that will permit to identify this UA value, that is a physical parameter of this box, the ventilation or infiltration heat loss coefficients, that is another physical parameter of this box, and you will identify those parameters based on some measurements. Yeah, and the measurements do not directly measure this UA. They will measure temperatures, they will measure heat flows, they will measure temperatures, they will measure volumetric flow rates of ventilation or infiltration. But we cannot measure the UA value directly. We get those values indirectly. But it is important to know what is the UA value, and it is important to know what are the heat loss coefficients of ventilation and infiltration, because if you don't know what they are, when you identify them, you cannot make a critical analysis of what did I identify? Is this reasonable? So let's start understanding what is this UA value. So, convection. The convection, these UA values, the UA values within this UA value, you consider three heat transfer mechanisms. Yeah, I will not go deep on them, but you have, first of all, the convection. The convection is the heat transfer of energy from the more energetic particles of a substance to the adjacent less energetic ones as a result of interaction between the particles. Convection can take place in solid, liquid, or gases. Yeah, and it's calculated with the Fourier's law. Yeah, Fourier was this guy that discovered the convection mathematical expression. And then basically the convection is, let us understand how the heat moves within the solids, but also happen in liquid and gases. So through the solid part of the building envelope, we will have convection. And then we have also a convection. Yeah. And the convection is another heat transfer phenomena. And the convection is the phenomena occurring from the surface of a solid to the fluid. In the building envelope, yeah, it's usually the surface temperature of the wall against the air temperature towards the indoors or towards the outdoors. Yeah, and we have some convection coefficients there. Then we have radiation. Yeah, and the radiation is the energy transmitted by matter in the form of the electromagnetic waves or photons as a result of the changes in the electronic configuration of the atoms and the molecules. Yeah, everything that has more than 0 Kelvin, yeah, 0 Kelvin is -260.73 Celsius degrees. Yeah, you don't know anything at that temperature, so anything it surrounds you is emitting radiation. Yeah, all the surfaces of the buildings, envelopes towards the interior and towards the exterior, they are emitting radiation. And actually, when you want to calculate the energy exchange by radiation of the building surface, the exterior or the interior, you have two things. The surroundings are emitting radiation. Yeah, the sky emits long wave radiation during night and during the day. And the surroundings, the trees, the buildings we have in front of us, they send radiation against our building envelope. But our building envelope will only absorb part of that radiation from the incident radiation. And then it will also emit radiation. So the emission will be calculated like this, the emissivity of our building envelope surface multiplied by a constant, the one of Stefan Boltzmann, multiplied by the area of our building envelope, multiplied by the surface temperature to the fourth in Kelvin, and will absorb a percentage alpha. This is called the absorptivity of the surface from the incident radiation. And the difference between of them is the radiation heat exchange. Yeah, so we have this, more or less. Building envelope, a simple wall. Usually the radiation heat transfer towards the interior is not considered in the calculation. So we will have from the earth to our surface convection, then we will have conduction through the wall. And then in the exterior surface, we will have three main heat transfer mechanisms. The convection towards the exterior air, the radiation exchange towards the sky and the surrounding buildings, and part of the solar energy striking our envelope will be absorbed by the external surface. So this is the reality. Yeah? And understanding the reality permits you to be very critical and understand what you get from the models you will be identifying through this set of webinars. Yeah, because the models will be able to identify the UA value from the indoor air to the exterior air. And within that UA value, this phenomena, the convection, the conduction, and these three phenomena will be considered. Yeah. So that's why it is important to know that they exist and how they are calculated, conduction, convection, and radiation. And then we have this issue about multidimensional heat transfer. Yeah, this is a building envelope. Yeah, we have a window in this wall, and the heat flow in winter is mainly from the interior at 20 degrees towards the exterior at 0 or 10 or 5 degrees. And this direction is the primary direction of the heat transfer. But remember that you also have two-dimensional problems. Yeah, because it's not a perfect wall. So you will have heat flows upwards and towards this direction. And they might affect the measurements or the signals that you are using for modeling. So in theory, how do you solve a conduction problem? A conduction problem is usually solved by taking this differential equation, you integrate it, you apply the boundary and initial condition, and you get the temperature distribution of the wall, and then you use the Fourier law to get the heat flow. Yeah, why do I present this? I will not go through this because it's not the aim of this course. But if you want to calculate by physical laws this conduction heat flow, it means that you have to know how the temperature is distributed within the wall. Yeah, this is perhaps 20 degrees, here is 21, here you have 18, here you have 16 degrees, and here you have 12 degrees. Yeah, this is a function that gives you the temperature within the wall. And once you know this temperature within the wall, you can calculate through these expressions the heat flows in any of the points of the wall. And the thing is that there is a specific case that is very useful in practice, that is when you have a steady state. What is the steady state? The steady state means that you have the inner surface of the wall at 20 degrees in all the surface, and the outer surface is at 3 degrees in the whole surface. Then the heat flow is one directional and the temperature distribution is one line. And there, the heat flow is calculated with this general expression, but since the temperature differential with X in a line is 20 degrees minus 3 divided by this thickness, you get this expression. And in this expression, if I take the thermal conductivity multiplied by the area here, I get a parameter called the thickness of the wall divided by the conductivity of the wall and divided by the area of the wall. And look at that expression. Heat flow, it's temperature difference by divided by something. I will call that something R, resistance. Why? Because everybody knows that in electrical circuits, we have a voltage difference divided by the electrical resistance and we get the intensity. Do you see that these two expressions are very similar? We have a potential, we have a resistance, and we have an intensity. We have a temperature potential, a temperature difference, we have a thermal resistance that we know how it's expressed and what is behind that thermal resistance, and here we have the heat flow. Yeah. And why is this so important? Because this thermal resistance, it's the thickness of the wall divided by the thermal conductivity and the area, is a typical parameter estimated within the modeling techniques that you will be using in this set of webinars. And now you know what is behind those identified thermal resistances. So once we have seen the thermal resistance for conduction, we also have a thermal resistance from the surface to the air. Yeah, and if we reorder the heat flow of convection, yeah, the heat going from the surface to the air, we get here a thermal resistance of convection. Yeah, and this is the expression of that thermal resistance. And usually in the outer surface of a building envelope, we lose heat towards the air through convection, but we also lose heat through radiation towards the surrounding temperature. Yeah, the surrounding temperature and the air temperature are not the same. They are similar, but they are not the same. And it's very typical that you assume they are the same as a modeling approach. So this radiation heat exchange can also be reordered and you get again a thermal resistance for the radiation heat exchange that has this expression here. And why do we do that? Because now we can go and model this wall with an electrical circuit. And these electrical circuits are the ones that are usually written down to identify models, and you identify these thermal resistances. Yeah, the resistance of the convection, the resistance of the wall, and the resistance of the convection. So you have a model from the indoor air to the outdoor air composed by thermal resistances. Yeah. When you identify them, you will not be able to identify them individually. Yeah, but you know what is behind those identified thermal resistances. And now, look at this. If I add this resistance, and this resistance, I get the total resistance from the indoor air to the outdoor air. And the inverse of that resistance, 1 divided by the total resistance, is the UA value. And the UA value is one of those things you will be identifying in your models. Yeah. And now you know what is behind that. When you have more than one wall, yeah, you have two resistances, one of the insulating layer and one of the, I don't know, concrete layer. Yeah, and you can go adding thermal resistance. The more layers you have in your wall, the more thermal resistance you have. If you have complex building envelopes that, I don't know, this is a typical brick, yeah, you can build thermal resistance circuits to represent the air here, this brick part here, and R5, this brick part. Yeah, and you can make thermal circuits to represent your reality. All this I have explained in the reference one you have at the end of this presentation. Yeah, you will see that you have it very well detailed, all I have explained here. But then when we go to analyze buildings, the building envelope is characterized by two main parameters. The UA value that represent the transmission heat losses of this building envelope, but then you will also have infiltrations. It's very hard to have a house without infiltration. Actually, it's nearly impossible because there will be, due to the wind, due to the temperature difference, there will be a pressure difference between the interior and exterior, and you will have a volumetric infiltration flow. This is some cubic meter per second, and entering through some windows, and they are leaving through other cracks. The air has a density, it has a specific heat, and it will enter at the outdoor temperature, and it will leave in the indoor temperature. So in winter, the infiltration will produce some heat losses. And to this pack, volumetric infiltration airflow multiplied by the density multiplied by the CP is called the infiltration heat loss coefficient. If you have ventilation systems with heat recovery, and the heat recovery, you know that the heat recovery is very useful because the outdoor air might be entering at 5 degrees. It will be heated with the air that is leaving the building at 20 degrees, and perhaps this will leave at 10 degrees, and the air entering will enter at 15 degrees. Yeah, this, if the flow rate is the same, leaving and entering, if this is heated up 10 degrees, this will be cooled down 10 degrees. Yeah, and that's very useful because then the heating demand will be only due to this difference. If you develop the equations of the energy conservation here, you will get that the ventilation system without heat recovery is the similar to the infiltration. Yeah, volumetric air multiplied by the raw air, CPR, T in to T out. But since we have heated the T out to T supply, we can develop these equations and we will get this expression for the ventilation heat loss coefficient, that is the volumetric air of the ventilation multiplied by the density of the air multiplied by the specific heat multiplied by 1 minus the efficiency of this device. If the efficiency is perfect, look, 1 minus 1, 0. There is no heat demand due to ventilation. And if we add this ventilation heat loss coefficient with the infiltration heat loss coefficient, we get the total ventilation plus infiltration heat loss coefficient. So these two values, the UA and the CV values, they are the main characteristics of the building envelope to be identified by the models of a building, yeah, regarding the building envelope, together with the heat gains due to solar radiation. So up to now, I have only presented what is behind the two parameters that we will try to identify in many buildings. The UA value that represents the transmission losses through the building envelope, and the CV value that is representing the ventilation plus infiltration heat losses. And okay, what can you measure in a building? Hey, you can measure many things. You can measure how many watts per square meter of solar radiation are striking in your building envelope in the different orientation. You can measure indoor temperature, you can measure outdoor temperature, you can measure the heating given with the heating system. You can measure how many occupants you have and their metabolic activity and how much heat they are producing. You can measure how much electricity is being produced in the building. And if you take this building envelope and you make an energy balance, yeah, this is the first law of thermodynamics, yeah, that the if you have, it is saying, if you have heat exchanges through the building envelope, if you have work exchanges through the building envelope, and you have mass flow rate entering through due to ventilation and infiltration with some energy and leaving some mass flow rates that are infiltration and ventilation with some energy, if this is not balanced, this is, imagine that is entering more heat than leaving, you will have an accumulation of heat in your building. So, if you apply that energy balance to what? To this type of signals. I told you, you can measure indoor temperature, outdoor temperature, the heat gains due to heating and occupancy and electricity conduction. This is the red line. Yeah, this is the typical building we occupy during the day, heated during the day, and that it's unoccupied during the night. And these are the solar gains occurring through the building envelope. It's zero at night, and it's when you have solar radiation, you have solar gains. These signals are the only thing you can measure to identify the heat loss coefficient, that is the sum of the UA value plus the CV value, transmission losses, infiltration, ventilation losses. It's a very important parameter of the building envelope. And using the energy balance in the building envelope in some periods, it is possible to use these signals that can be measured through energy balances, identify the heat loss coefficient. This development is detailed in this reference too, but I will show you the easiest case. If you have the heat loss coefficient, will be all the heat inputs during a period within the building envelope divided by the average temperature difference between indoor and outdoor during that period. Yeah. It must be in winter, very cold periods. The use of this equation to estimate this heat loss coefficient based on measurable signal, this is the heating gains, the electrical and occupants metabolic heat gains, and the solar gains divided by the indoor temperature minus the outdoor temperature, cannot be applied in any period of time. It must be only if it's cold and cloudy, because then this value is very small, because this value usually has high uncertainties, and the bigger the temperature difference, the uncertainties are also reduced. So now we will go to see how you can measure this type of signals, yeah, because in your models you use indoor temperature signals, outdoor temperature signals, heat gains signals, and solar gains signals. Yeah, and those signals must be produced by sensors. Yeah, so dynamic testing of building components requires a very well controlled and positioned set of sensors with a correct measuring and control system that will provide high quality data sets. Yeah, and for you to know, there is there were some European projects called PASSIS and PASLINK projects where they develop very detailed and very good quality requirements for full scale testing of building components. Yeah, I will explain you how to test, how to make measuring of those signals for building components. The thing is that these quality requirements are extendable and valid for whole building cases. So let's start. This is a PASLINK tester. Yeah, it's a very big cube. Yeah, where you put a wall that you want to test under real weather conditions. Here you have a ventilated facade, and this here you have a white wall. Yeah, it was a calibration wall in this case. And this is 8 meters. This is 3 meters, and this is 3 meters to make you an idea of the size. So imagine that we want to get the UA value of this wall. This is the wall. In this case, it also has a window. So we also want to obtain some characteristic of the heat gains due to the solar radiation that is usually calculated as the solar aperture. Yeah, the solar aperture is the equivalent size of the window that will produce the same heat gain in the interior of the building regarding the global solar radiation striking in that envelope. So you have exterior temperature, you can measure it, you have interior temperature, you can measure it, you can produce some heat input within this test room to produce a temperature difference between the interior and the exterior, you can measure the solar radiation, and you can measure all the heat going through all the walls except the component where you want to make the characterization. We want to obtain thermal characteristics of this component. The UA value is one of the main values we want to identify, and also in this case, the solar gains. So the idea is to, as I told you, produce a big temperature difference between interior and exterior. Once we have this big temperature difference, we have a small error in this temperature difference. We produce a heating signal with some characteristics to permit to make the identification software easier, the identification of these parameters, UA and solar aperture. And in this case, there are some sensors that require to measure all the heat flux through all these walls. You cannot put this type of heat flux sensors in components where you have windows, so, because they don't measure it correctly. So you have to make an indirect measurement of the heat flow through this energy balance in this test room. So how do you measure temperature? When we measure indoor air temperature, this test box is this test box. You see these elements here. Those are indoor air temperature sensors with a shielding against radiation. And even if you put temperature sensors within them that are called PT100, there are two types of measuring air temperature, thermocouples or thermoresistances. I will show you them later on. When you measure the air temperature in 7 points, you see that even if you have an accuracy of 0.1 degree, if you make the maximum temperature minus the minimum temperature, you might go even to 0.3 degrees. So you have to be careful. You cannot put the uncertainty of the sensor manufacturer to the signal. The indoor air temperature of that test room is not the uncertainty of the manufacturer. The uncertainty of the manufacturer is 0.1 degree, but the uncertainty of the measurement might be bigger than the manufacturer uncertainty, because you will make the average of these 7 signals and you will have an uncertainty of that signal for your model that it's not the sensor manufacturer uncertainty, but it will be slightly bigger in this case. Behind the temperature measurement is a very complex thing, and it's based in the third law of thermodynamics that says that if this body B is in thermal equilibrium with C and this body B is in thermal equilibrium with A, A and C, they are also in thermal equilibrium, and A and C, they have the same temperature. So if you calibrate a temperature sensor A with B, then if you use A to measure any other thing, it will give you a calibrated temperature measurement. What are those devices to measure temperatures? Those devices that provide you signals for your modeling, the signals of temperature are usually generated by this type of sensors. Thermocouples, they are two wires with different material welded in one point, and when you put that in a place with a certain temperature, you generate a voltage. And that voltage is bigger the higher the temperature of this point. So you are actually measuring a voltage of a joint of two materials. And then you convert that into a temperature with a thermocouple, just for you to know in your mind. And other types of measuring the temperatures are called thermoresistances. Nearly all the tests, or most of the tests, use these two technologies for measuring temperatures. A thermoresistance is usually called PT100, because here, this is a thermoresistance for measuring surface temperature. I don't know if you see it, but here you have a very, very long wire. This wire is made of platinum, and when this wire is at 0 degrees, it has a thermal an electrical resistance of 100 ohms. Yeah, so what you actually measure are the ohms. And the higher the temperature of this sensor, the electrical resistance increases. And you know for each electrical resistance what is the equivalent temperature. Yeah, and this is why they are called thermoresistances. So when you find temperature signals, they are always generated by or nearly always thermocouples or thermoresistances. And here, yeah, in this box, we also measure the surface temperatures in many points. Yeah, in the east, west, ceiling, floor, in the north. These small boxes are some temperature sensors. You cannot see them in this photo, but you will see it later on. So when you measure the surface temperature of the box, you will find a much higher variability. Those sensors has 0.1 degrees of manufacturer uncertainty. But if you make the maximum minus the minimum temperature, you can go up to 1.1 degrees. So you have to be careful if you want to use just one surface temperature in your models, how to get that surface temperature, because there might be surfaces that have very different temperatures in your real case, and you have to translate that to your models. Usually you have to make some assumptions and some simplifications. So here you have an example of a whole test where you have the air temperature and this is the surface temperature. And when you heat up the test room, the air temperature is heated first and then the surface temperature, it goes slower following the air temperature. This is an example. Another signal, very common in the modeling techniques, the outdoor temperature. Here you have this pass-linked cell measuring the outdoor temperature in the roof with this shielded, not mechanically ventilated, and here with a shielded, mechanically ventilated. You can measure it also, the air with below the test cell. And if you put all those temperature measurements together, you find that between them, they might be up to 5 degrees of difference, mainly during sunny hours. When there are sunny hours, the outdoor air temperature measurement is very difficult to do correctly. Yeah, because if it's not correctly shielded against solar radiation and mechanically ventilated, you might find that the sensor is not giving you the air temperature, but is giving you another temperature that is correlated to the solar radiation striking on the sensor. And then the hardest measurements are related to solar radiation. Yeah, the sun emits at 5,800 Kelvin. So it's emitting, according to the Stefan Boltzmann law, like this, at different wavelengths. Yeah, the wavelength of the radiation is very different if it's emitted at 5,800 Kelvin or if it's emitted at 300 Kelvin. When we emit at 300 Kelvin, the radiation we emit, it's not in the visible frame. So when we switch off all the lights, we cannot see the radiation emitted by us. So the radiation of the sun, or the one we emit, it strikes the building envelope, and if it's a semi-transparent element, part can be transmitted, part can be absorbed, and part can be reflected. Yeah, the radiation a surface will have an absorptivity, a reflectivity, and a transmissivity. Yeah, and the sum of absorptivity plus reflectivity plus transmittivity is always one. Yeah. So in the building envelope, the radiation emitted by the surroundings is absorbed in a 90% because it was emitted at low temperature. But the radiation emitted by the sun is absorbed in the 60%. Yeah, so the absorptivity of a surface is different depending on the temperature at which the radiation was emitted. And we have to be very careful with that in our modeling. Yeah, because that's why we have to treat differently the radiation from the sun and the radiation exchange with the surroundings. Yeah, usually the radiation exchange with the surroundings is treated by this term, emissivity of our surface multiplied by the Stefan-Boltzmann constant multiplied by the sky temperature to the fourth minus the surface temperature to the fourth. And for the solar radiation, we only consider what percentage of the striking solar radiation we absorb. And that is the net radiation heat exchange. So what can we measure? We can measure this value, G solar, and it is also possible to measure T sky, and also possible to measure the surface temperature. Yeah, and we usually identify emissivities and absorptivities through our modeling. So the solar radiation strikes the atmosphere, and then it crosses all the atmosphere. And look at this. In the space, this is the solar radiation. And after crossing the atmosphere, it is reduced, the radiation that is striking the Earth surface. And a part of being absorbed, its direction is changed. So the solar radiation striking the Earth has two parts. A diffuse part that has changed the direction due to the reflection within the atmosphere, and a direct part. So the global solar radiation considers both the diffuse part and the direct part. So this type of sensors, pyranometers, they usually measure the global solar radiation, and they are usually the input for your models. And the global solar radiation has within it the sum of these two, diffuse plus direct. So here you have the three solar radiation measurements that you usually can have. Bueno, these two are solar, and this is the long wave radiation. This one will be measuring the global, the diffuse solar radiation plus the direct, and this ball is making a shadow to this device that is exactly the same as this one, but this one is only measuring the diffuse part. So with these two, you can get by subtraction the direct part. And this third one is called a pyrgeometer. And the pyrgeometer is measuring this radiation, the long wave radiation. This one is measuring the solar radiation, the global one. And this one is measuring the diffuse radiation here. But this one, the third one called pyrgeometer, is the one that permits you to obtain the sky temperature. So the pyrgeometer is measuring in the long wave radiation, only the radiation emitted in this wavelength. So now that you have seen what you can measure, when you are going to model the radiation, you know that the global solar radiation is usually modeled with an absorptivity for the global solar radiation, and the long wave radiation can be used to obtain the sky temperature. Yeah, so that's, you will find those signals in your exercises during this webinar. And then what else you can measure? You can measure the wind meter high and in the window, in the building component you are testing. You can measure the wind direction, which is the direction, and you can consider that in your modeling. You can measure the rain precipitation in case you want to consider it in your modeling, or you can even measure the atmospheric pressure. Yeah, and if it's an special component, it might be in your modeling approaches. And then you have the power generated in your, in this case, in the test room. Here you have an electrical resistance, and in the electrical resistance, it's very easy to measure with very high precision wattmeters how many watts, you see here watts, which is the power you are introducing in your room or in your building. Yeah, the electrical power. And then in this case, we also had some heat flux measurement tiles. Yeah, and these heat flux measurement tiles were in all the building envelope. These are heat flux sensors, and they measure how many watts per square meter are crossing that wall. So finally, when you are going to model things, you will find this type of signals. You will find outdoor temperature in degrees. You will find indoor temperature, the green one. The blue one is the surface indoor the surface temperature in the indoor surface of the test room. And you will find how many watts you are introducing in your building. Yeah, because it's also measurable. And this blue line was measuring the heat flux through those heat flux tiles in the walls. Yeah, because it's also possible to measure how many watts per square meter are crossing through opaque elements. So these are the typical signals you will find for modeling. And now, at least, you have an idea of how do you get them? Yeah, how they are produced. Yeah, and what is behind the production of those signals. And many times when you have a special building components, this is a concrete insulation, concrete and gravel covered roof, you might install sensors like this, 5 temperature sensors per layer, a heat flux sensors, and you will find this. Yeah, this is the interior surface of concrete, of the concrete layer. Yeah, this is a heat flux sensor, and these are the 5 surface temperature sensors. And they are not going exactly the same. There will be a difference in the inner surface temperature between the surface temperatures. So you have to know that that is happening in your modeling when you are modeling things. And the heat flux in the interior surface, in between these two surfaces, in between these two surfaces, and in between these two surfaces, they might have this behavior. Yeah, the heat flux is not the same here, 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 and here. Yeah, here you have an example of how it varies depending on the position of the heat flux sensor. And finally, you always need a data acquisition system with some computers to control whatever you are measuring. Yeah, and they also have importance in the accuracy of the measurements. And when you translate this to whole buildings, yeah, this is a whole building. In a building, you usually have, when you make monitorings, you usually use other type of sensors. Yeah, you usually use commercial sensors. This is the typical commercial sensors for measuring. This is the heating system tubes. Here you have the hot water going to the radiators, and this is the return one. If you measure the volumetric flow rate, the temperature and the temperature, you might know how many watts you are putting as heating to your building or a thermal zone of a building. The temperature, CO2, and relative humidity measurements are usually done by this type of more beautiful sensors than the ones I show you in the test component, where you have higher precisions, but they are not usable in buildings, because in buildings you require some aesthetics for the monitoring systems. The electricity consumption within the building, it's very easy to measure in the electrical boards using wattmeters. They say you how many kilowatts per hour you have consumed within some thermal zones of a building. And then you usually have to measure in the ventilation systems. For the ventilation system, you usually have to measure the supply, indoor temperature, outdoor temperature, and exhaust temperature together to the volumetric flow rates to be able to calculate the ventilation heat loss coefficients. Yeah. So all this about how to make monitoring and measuring in buildings, you can find it in this third reference. Yeah. I know I only had 50 minutes. It's a lot of material, and I let you hear 3 references where I explain the first part of the presentation here, the second part here, and the part about the monitoring part is in this reference. So this is all from my part. I think I have stick to the time.